各位传媒朋友早晨，多谢大家今朝嚟呢个记者会。稍后行政长官咧会先向大家发言，之后接受大家提问。因为疫情关系咧，请大家喺记者会入边咧都系尽量保持距离。我哋而家先请行政长官发言。
各位传媒朋友，各位香港市民，早晨。听日咧，我将会系发表我任内第五份，亦都系本届政府最后一份嘅施政报告啊。我留意到近日社會大眾對於呢份施政報告咧都有好多討論。雖然係最後一份施政報告，但係我同埋我團隊咧非常之重視呢一份嘅施政報告。我親自主持咗40场嘅諮詢會，包括係有走入去學校啦，有一啲係直播嘅諮詢會啦，亦都有同唔同界別喺線上同埋線下嘅接觸。咁我哋估計大概咧有3500人咧，係透過呢啲線上線下嘅諮詢會咧，係參與過2021年施政報告嘅公眾諮詢。喺呢度咧係率先向所有發表咗意見嘅朋友咧係致謝，因為同時間咧我哋亦都係收到有3800份書面或者係電郵嘅意見書嚇。就一如大家所料，同埋好多調查都係有同樣嘅發現啦。市民喺意見書裏邊最關心嘅第一個議題咧係房屋同埋土地供應啊。咁所以而家喺坊間好多討論咧，都係同未來香港嘅房屋同埋土地供應啦。今日當然唔會預先公布關於施政報告嘅內容嚇，亦都冇乜俾大家嘅驚喜，因為一如既往都係咁嘅顏色嚇。呢個係2021年嘅施政報告嚇，就呢份係正文啦，我將會喺明天咧就喺立法會宣讀。咁啊，預先話俾大家聽有心理準備咧，佢嘅幅度係同往年好接近嘅。換句話說，都要2个几钟头咧先可以讀完呢一份嘅施政報告。另一個咧係施政報告嘅附篇，呢個係我哋第三次咧。係支持呢份施政報告嘅內容咧，係出現咗一個嘅附篇啊。咁啊，似乎啊過去2年都係受到市民同埋社會嘅歡迎，因為裏邊啊圖文並茂，都係可以睇到香港喺各方面嘅發展。今年嘅附篇嘅幅度係特別長嘅嚇，就我諗係比往年咧係長多個一半嘅篇幅。一共喺中文版係168頁。個原因係因為正如我頭先講啦。呢一本施政報告係5年任期嘅最後一份施政報告，咁所以我哋都利用呢個施政報告嘅附篇咧，係總結一下呢一屆政府喺呢4年几嘅工作，同埋全面向社會交代我哋喺過往4份施政報告裏邊嘅900多項嘅政策嘅措施嘅落實嘅情況嚇。所以喺附篇裏邊咧，希望即係大家都揾到。大家以往關心過有關於一啲新嘅措施咧，係取得嘅成效。咁就正如我所講咧，就今年嘅施政報告會聚焦未來嚇。咁當然喺未來裏邊咧，就經濟發展好重要啦，融入國家發展大局好重要。但係我完全明白市民重中之重咧，係希望政府能夠解決房屋同埋土地嘅問題。反之喺一啲紓困嘅措施咧，我早前都喺呢度先後2次公布咗，包括喺8月31号同埋9月21号咧，就係有啲需要政府延續嘅寬減租金啊政府收費嘅措施咧，我哋已經公布咗啦。另外有一批係延續我哋嘅擔保嘅貸款，特別係針對中小企同埋個人咧，亦都係公布咗啦。咁所以施政報告係唔會再有篇幅咧去處理一啲係比較針對新冠疫情引發到之後嗰個嘅需要我哋支援嘅地方。當然喺呢一段時間裏邊，隨住疫情嘅發展同埋社會經濟嘅情況咧，有需要嘅時候，我相信各個司局長咧再會係提出需要做嘅措施啦。今日喺嘅背後咧，係某程度上係為2021年嘅施政報告咧，係帶出佢個背景。個背景咧就係我哋迎來一個新嘅局面，同埋面對好多新嘅機遇。呢個新嘅局面當然咧就係香港回到一國兩制嘅正確嘅軌道。通過中央嘅2大舉措啦，分別係已經落實咗超過1年多嘅香港國安法。令到社會回復穩定，國家安全得以保證。 另一個就是完善選舉的制度，三場重要選舉的首場亦都順利進行了，可以確保愛國者治港。有了這兩大的舉措，令到香港有了一個穩定的環境，我在諮詢的過程，很多人都自發性地說現在是做事的時候了，因為已經有了一個穩定的環境，有了一個不是泛政治化、逢政府必反、逢中央的事情都必反的政治的生態，是應該更為香港謀劃未來，希望能夠可以帶來一個新的景象。所以這個是我所謂的新的局面那個的情況。至於新的機遇更加多了，大家都知道了，今年是國家"十四五"規劃的開局之年。今年對於香港的支持，在個"十四五"規劃裏面，對於香港的支持是前所未有咁豐富的，包括我時常講的有八大中心啦，亦都係我哋繼續在粵港澳大灣區裏面會扮演一個重要的角色啦。咁近日亦都係公布了前海的擴區方案同埋橫琴嘅粵澳嘅深度合作區嘅方案，呢啲都會為香港帶嚟無限嘅機遇。咁所以呢份施政報告咧，亦都希望係著眼呢啲未來同埋找緊呢啲機遇。我再講多幾句咧，就是、事實上而家香港嘅處於個情況係非常之好嘅。當然係疫情仍然係困擾住大家，係未能夠可以免檢疫通關回到內地，同埋喺海外旅遊咧都係大家。即係好焦慮，希望我哋盡快可以處理得到。咁呢個工作咧，仍然喺施政報告裏邊咧，會視之為而家嘅頭等大事。我哋每日都係循住呢個盡早通關嘅政策方向咧嚟到去努力。但係點解我話即係個形勢或者個勢頭咧係好嘅？呢啲係從事實同埋數據裏邊係可以反映出嚟嘅。香港上半年嘅2021年上半年的本地經濟生產總值是按年實質增長 7.8%， 所以早前已經調校了今年全年的預測是應該做到 5.5% 到 6.5%。 同樣地，我們也都見到有一些經濟的板塊是出現了甚至以前沒有見過的良好的景象，譬如在貨物的出入口，貨物貿易方面的總額頭8個月是高達65萬億港元，65萬億港元這個數字是破紀錄的，是比去年同期增加了 28%， 也是歷史的新高來的。至於在金融市場裏面，當然近日個市調整，大家又開始有些即係擔心，但是首8個月香港的首次公開招股，即係 IPO 集資的總額是2698億港元，是比去年同期也是上升了80%。當然有人認為就第三季好像比較慢了一些，因為在外圍有些事發生，但是從交易所的主席和總裁口中，我知道是有很多公司是排緊隊，是等緊在香港來到上市的。在發債方面有些很令人振奮的消息，一方面我們香港在頭九個月由我們安排的亞洲國際債券的量是比同期亦都是增加了 6%， 高達1630億美元。先後國家的財政部就已經公布了稍後會發行美元的債券和人民幣的國債，首次由一個市政府，即係深圳市政府咧，亦都會將喺呢個月咧就會發行50億元嘅離岸人民幣嘅地方債券，其中係包括一啲綠債嘅嚇。咁呢個我同阿黃偉忠書記講咧，都係對我哋嘅金融發展、互聯互通咧係一大嘅裨益。咁所以稍後我知道咧，深港兩地都會有一個少少嘅儀式咧嚟到去慶祝呢一次嘅深圳市喺香港發債嗰個情況啦。在機場方面，客運當然是很慘淡，每日都係得幾千客，但在貨運方面咧，那個恢復的速度是非常之快的。我哋在2020年咧，仍然是全球的貨運空運的貨運的第一位啦。咁喺今年嘅8月，即係最新公布的數字咧，亦都係比舊年同期咧係增加了 15.5%。咁所以全年落嚟喺貨運方面嗰個都應該係一個理想的。當然最終影響到民生是就業，大家都知道我們的失業率由年初很高的 7.2% 已經逐步下降到最新的 4.7%， 隨住而家消費比較蓬勃啦，大家都睇到個情況咧，相信下一次再公布嘅三個月嘅數字咧，都會係比4.7%更加低嚇。點解咁樣講咧？因為已經開始請唔到人啦。在勞工處最新今年六月到八月，我哋收到嘅每個月嘅所謂喺私營機構嘅空缺咧，係高達96,429個，係比舊年同期咧係上升咗69%。咁即係説明好多企業見到生意好翻咧，係需要請人。我亦都問過一啲做餐飲嘅，真係請唔到人啦，開始入。咁所以呢啲數據全部都係好令人振奮。咁所以我覺得呢一份施政報告喺咁嘅新局面、新嘅機遇同埋新嘅基礎之下咧，希望能夠得到市民嘅支持。好，我嘅介紹到呢度，睇下大家有咩提問。
而家提問時間，希望提問記者先舉手啦，嗌到你之後先介紹你嘅傳媒機構，然之後用我哋俾你嘅麥發問。左邊呢位記者先。
特首你好，中評社。本港專家之前講話，內地要求本港防疫措施，即係盡量貼近內地標準啦，包括呢個收緊機組人員、海外人員嘅豁免檢疫政策。檢疫酒店人員、機場員工假日需要核酸檢測。特區政府係咪會唔會進一步做出呢個改善，為通關創造條件？同埋下一步點樣完善本港嘅防疫措施同內地對接 ？Thank you。
好，我都知道有關於通關問題咧，都係大家最關心嘅。咁所以我頭先都講啦，無論我哋對於香港未來有幾多嘅大計咧，而家頭等大事都係盡快更加好咁控制嗰個疫情咧，係達至可以同內地免檢疫咧係人員往來嚇。這個所指為通關嘅概念咧，就係有人可以免檢疫咁進入內地，或者喺外邊嘅人亦都可以免檢疫咁嚟到香港。在兩者之間咧，好清楚過去呢一段時間咧，我哋已經講得好清楚咧，個重點係內地，因為無論同經濟、民生各方面咧，香港市民係需要更加可以進入去內地嚇。當然國際旅遊對我哋緊要，一啲國際嘅商務活動對我哋緊要，但係喺兩者嘅比較之下咧，仍然係內地係更加緊要嘅。即使係喺香港嘅外國商會，我都係咁同佢哋講。這些外國的企業選擇在香港成立公司，其實很多都在內地有業務，所以對他們來說能夠進入去內地看看生意或者跟投資者談談是非常重要。所以毫無疑問，今天特區政府的首要任務是達至是內地的通關。早前政務司司長已經是率團去深圳開了首次的對接會議，我也很感謝韓正副總理是很知道我們那個急切的需求，所以在他的指導之下，我們也開了這個首次的會議。這個首次的會議當然的討論的範圍很廣泛，我也不想詳細交代，但我們特區政府的立場是很清晰的，只要達至有序可以給回我們人員往來免檢疫，中央要我們做些什麼措施，改善些什麼程序，我們全部都是會盡最大的努力去做。但當然在這個過程裡面都要看看是否做得到，有些事是未必做得到的，未必做得到我們都會盡量令到它做得到，但是實際上究竟是全部做得到，做到九成，抑或是怎樣呢？要等我們有了內地專家的回饋的意見，我們自己內部再評核，我們會在第一時間再告訴他們聽，我們是可以做得到的，亦都可以進行第二次的對接。所以那個立場很清晰的，為了達至通關，特區政府是願意樂意，亦都會是很銳意去改善所有從內地的體制認為我們是可以更加達至和內地一致性，或者更加令到他們是有信心香港這套防疫制度是不會成為一個缺口，我們一定會做。
下一條提問，後面各位女記者。
Hello, Mrs. Lam. This is from the South China Morning Post. The first question, the Danish artist behind the Pillar of Shame.
Sorry, I can't hear you. You have to speak up.
Okay, sure. My first question is, The Danish artist behind the Pillar of Shame urged the Hong Kong U to let the statue remain in the campus, saying that the removal of it would be offensive and profane. So as the Kong U's chancellor, what's your take on this? Second question, more district councillors have been removed from office, but there are still 2 years before the election. What would the government deal with this vacuum? And could you clarify rumours that the government would take away the district council's power of allocating funds? And the third question, how would you respond to reports based on the Pandora paper that accused Siwa Leung of hiding the wealth from the public? Would the government do anything about this? Thanks.
Well, of the three questions, well, first of all, under the basic law, rights and freedoms of individuals are being safeguarded. So that's point number one, including artistic freedom and academic freedom. Secondly, is this incident happens in the university campus. So I would expect the university management to handle it according to their own policy. As a chancellor of not only the Hong Kong University, but other universities, I do not get myself involved or interfered into the affairs of the university. The second question about district council members, right now we are in the third batch. We still have another batch of serving district council members who will be invited to take their oath, with the Secretary of Home Affairs being the oath administrator. So our position is we will act in strict accordance with the basic law requirement, the national security law requirement, and the local legislation, and to decide whether a serving district council member could fulfill the obligations under these legal requirements, and if not, they could no longer serve as a district council member. So once all these have been settled, so including the third batch, which is now going on, and another batch which will shortly be invited to take the oath, then the government will have an idea of how these 18 district councils will be constituted. And then, of course, we have to decide whether they are still functional in a fair and efficient manner. For example, some district councils will be left with only a couple of district council members that they could not even have a chairman, no quorum, but at the same time, they do have a lot of influence in allocating district council funds or deciding on which district minor works should be undertaken with public money. So we do have a duty to take all these factors into account and then decide on the way forward. Because as you rightly pointed out, they still have a term of about 2 years in the current tenure. But I'm not in a position to tell you now what will happen, except to make it very clear that under Basic Law 97, as well as local legislation, district councils are not given power. Unlike the Legislative Council, district councils by themselves, they do not possess power to make decisions, to employ staff, or to allocate money. The inference that we have given district councils over the years is out of respect and recognition of the representativeness of these members. We have allowed them to have a say on the use of the public money which is controlled by a public official in the name of the Director of Home Affairs. So that is the constitutional position. So it does not constitute any taking away of power as you have described. But I hope this is a matter of semantics. I'm sure you understand the constitutional status of district councils is that they are advisory bodies to give advice when being asked by the government and also to advise on the use of funds when being asked by the government. Now, the third point, I can only generally talk about our declaration system. We have a very robust declaration of interest system, both applicable to executive council members as well as principal officials. And these are disclosed to the public for inspection under what we call an annual declaration of registrable interests. And what is a registrable interest that needs to be declared is clearly laid out in the form that you can find on the website. So I don't want to comment on individual cases except to impress upon you that we have a very robust system. But at the end of the day, this is our honor system. We do not check, monitor, or investigate into registrable interests of each member. But you can see for yourselves on the existing website about the current members on the Executive Council that they have declared in a very detailed and meticulous way their beneficial interests. Thank you.
今天最後一位，後排最遠的位女記者。
咁睇你好，商台頭先都係想問翻國商之處啦，因為如果連國商之處都沒即係移走咗港大而六四燭光晚會又不可以再繼續舉行的話，咁會不會是一個抹殺歷史的一個即係現象咧？喺香港。另外頭先講到通關嗰度咧，即係雖然你一直都喺度講話，即係都同啲商會有講啦，但係歐洲商會啱啱就接受咗訪問，就話即係形容而家係香港好似兩頭唔到岸咁樣啦，歐美又通唔到，內地又通唔到咁樣啦。咁你哋會點樣繼續遊說佢哋，即係將個總部繼續設喺香港咧？另外第三條就想問翻嗰個反外國制裁法嘅，因為而家仲未見到佢哋擺上去全國人大常委會嗰個時間表啦，係咪考慮到商界啲憂慮咧？唔該。
第一個問題，正如我所講咧，基本法係保障各樣嘅個人嘅自由嚇同埋權利嘅嚇。咁至於每一個機構點樣管理喺佢個機構擁有嘅處所裏邊展示啲咩嘢，當然係依法辦事啦，同埋佢自己作為管理機構咧要作出呢個嘅判斷嚇。第二，關於通關的問題，我剛才已經詳細回應了我們的立場，但是你一部分的問題就是現在外國商會如何看香港。我留意到這位歐洲商會的代表，他都是認為落實了實施了香港國安法之後，不但沒有影響，是令到營商環境更加有利，因為社會穩定了，亦都冇咗一啲黑暴，出街亦需唔需要擔心，亦都唔應該亦都唔會因為話支持政府咧，會俾人去起底啊，或者係攻擊咁。呢個係更加重要嘅信息。至於所謂兩頭唔到岸，正如頭先我形容啦嚇。如果我哋想同內地通關，我哋係要更加接近內地嗰套嘅政策嚇，而唔係即係好似有啲地方咁咧，我哋同病毒共存嚇。咁所以如果有啲同病毒共存嘅地方要嚟嘅時候，我哋一定要好嚴格咁去管制輸入嚇。如果唔係外防輸入做唔好咧，根本就唔使諗點樣可以即係同一個唔接受與病毒共存個內地咧嚟到講通關嚇。咁呢個情形咧，佢哋都了解啊，我都親自應該係回答過佢哋咧個情況係咁樣樣嚇，希望大家都係諒解。至於你話點樣遊說佢哋繼續將佢個總部或者辦事處擺喺香港咧？聽日公布嘅施政報告會同時公布我哋最新對於海外同埋內地嘅企業喺香港設置嘅辦事處嚇。咁大家會睇到咧，同樣我都講啦，即係國安法嘅頒布咧冇影響到呢啲嘅數字嘅嚇。就香港嘅營商環境係嗰個優勝嘅地方。是有目共睹，無論是我們的傳統優勢、法治精神、我們的國際聯繫、我們的使用的英語環境諸如此類，以至到新給了香港的這麼多的機遇。第三個問題，關於反外國制裁法，從一個香港作為中華人民共和國的不可分離的部分，以及今次這些所謂的制裁是衝著香港而來的，所以香港特別行政區的立場，包括本人的立場，一定是支持國家。如果國家認為這條全國性的法律需要納入附件三來到去適用於香港，我早前都講了，由於我們的實際環境，我們作為一個金融中心，應該用本地立法，有一個諮詢的過程才能夠體現得到怎樣去落實這條反制裁法。但是我同時亦都是清楚同大家講，中央今日冇時間表嚇，到佢要考慮嘅時候咧，我得到嘅信息咧就一定係會係好認真咁去睇香港嗰個金融中心嘅地位。呢個就係今日嗰個嘅情況嚇。咁但係我並冇收到有任何嘅時間表，或者幾時會係喺人大常委會裏邊咧討論呢個議題。多謝大家。